welcome to the video and the second day of 2015. I'm going to try and do my best here to really bring the intensity and put our attention on the root of our situation. This is where we make progress, when we're able to put our attention on the root and keep our attention there as much as possible. And of course, there'll be wows coming, like, wow, I'm really doing it. This is where we make the kind of progress that we deserve. So, last couple days, real tough for me. And by applying the practice that I have been advising, I've been able to keep going. Hasn't been easy. But I'm still making tremendous progress and saying, you know what, this is great. It's just, I wish it was a little quicker, but just have to be patient. Understand, it's the continuity fear. The success is coming so rapidly, I'm a little bit like, whoa, it's a little too rapid. Okay, so it's a question of again, the progress being a little overwhelming, actually. And the need to just be patient, it'll come. The answers will come, and they are arriving. So, what we do here is I find it's fresher and more vibrant and more intense than what I see other, you know, what else is there on YouTube, in the world, really. If there was something else better, I'd be watching it. I was just watching something about the whistleblower, you know, colony on Mars and all this stuff, and I said, this is great, but actually, what the information I have is more important, is more intense, it's way more vital. So I said, well, let's take a little break from that, you know, maybe get back to it later, but let's do some taping right now, taping. Because ultimately, all that stuff, the whole scenario is going on, and there is so much going on, and the whistleblowers are doing a good job, let's say that, they are. The information is coming out now, and it will continue to come out during the next 18 months and until something happens. It could be the Pope may bring out extraterrestrials and say they're here and they're helping us with our New World religion now, and some scenario like that may very well take place. And so all these whistles, this all coming out now about what's going on, I call cosmic corporate culture, cosmic corporate culture taking over this planet, incorporating this planet. And that is absolutely happening. And so this is very interesting to, you know, at a certain level. But ultimately, this isn't the problem at all. It doesn't matter at all, actually. It's like saying what happens in a dream stays in a dream, you know? It doesn't matter to reality, actually, at all. So it's way more important to keep your focus on the spiritual path, actually, and understand what it is, you know, what is it that we're doing here? I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. None of us are bodies, none of us have ever had bodies. We've never been incomplete, we've never had any needs at all. It's impossible for what we are to be just perfect freedom to have any needs. Now, this is the very key. Ultimately, our one problem is the continuity problem. We don't have a stupidity problem. Say, I do not have a stupidity problem, I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have, but it's very severe. The stupidity problem doesn't have any value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. And this is very important. I don't have we pretend to be embarrassed about our stupidity. You know, it's like, I'm so embarrassing, I can't do the spiritual path fast enough. No, we have a very severe problem. So what we practice here is based on the confession, the true confession of seeing, I have a very severe problem. It's a real, quote unquote, real problem. The other stuff is trivial. You know, I could easily dispel it, but I know that. But for some reason, I can't easily dispel it. Why? Because it's not really a problem for us. But the continuity problem, the familiarity problem, is a severe problem for us. That's why it takes so long, and that's why we have to have patience. But once we, you know, confess this and realize it, then we really can make progress, tremendous progress. And the way we do that is focusing on the root of it as much as possible. Ramana Maharshi said, the I is like the belief in need. I need, like, I need dot 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 anything. I need is the I need. There is no need. We don't have any need. Spirit doesn't have any need. Reality doesn't even need reality, so to speak. It's not needy, it is. So we put the focus on need. Okay, Ramana would say, on the I, put your attention. What is this I? You know, what is this belief in need? You know, need. Very important. We're looking at a picture, talking about Madison Bumgarner, the pitcher from the Giants. He's really legendary, you know, legendary pitcher of the Giants. And I noticed, and other people have noticed, says, my God, he looks like Jesus, you know, at least Jesus, depictions of Jesus, you know, painting, whatever. And other people have noticed it too. And he even said, what's your goal in life? And he said, I wish my goal in life is that people see a little bit of Jesus in me. That's his purpose in life. It's funny because he looks, someone put like his head on a famous, beautiful graphic of Jesus with rays of light and glory coming out. And he put his head on it. It looked just like, wow, that's Jesus. This is amazing. But Madison Bumgarner is not Jesus, okay? Although some Giant fans may believe that he has some attributes, but he really, it's not so, okay? But who is like Jesus? Is there anyone in the world that we can point to and say, you know what, I think that I believe, I can see, you know, Jesus is probably a lot like this. You know, who is it? Ramana Maharshi is an answer for that, one of the answers you can give. No question about it. If you really want to have a good idea of what Jesus is, Ramana Maharshi, if you can see past the image and the concept of Ramana Maharshi, if you can see past it, you realize that it dissolves and there isn't any. Ramana Maharshi has no concept of Ramana Maharshi. You see, Ramana Maharshi has no thoughts of Ramana Maharshi. Okay, reality doesn't need reality, so to speak. There's no need there. It just is. It's just the isness with wearing a mask that we call Ramana Maharshi. But it's not Ramana Maharshi, actually. It's just a mask we call Ramana Maharshi. Okay, so there's an example. That's how Jesus is. Jesus is. Okay, and so are we, as a matter of fact. So are we. So I guess in some way, Bumgarner and us and everyone, we all also are Jesus, because we all is. We can say we are. I am. I am, we are, all is. I am, we are, all is. I am, we are, all is. Without any need. Without any need. A need to what? To complete. A need to be defined. A need to be completed. A need for something other than what is. No, there's no need for anything other than what is. So, now, when we, let's say we came across Ramana Maharshi, what would we do? Well, I'll tell you what we would do. Consider this. We just sit down and be very quiet. Why? Because we would be practicing full stop in the wow, because the wow would be tremendous. And this is the way you go. If you go to see a teacher like that, you just be quiet. Just be quiet. Because you are in an incredibly auspicious situation. And that is, wow. This is tremendous. And never be cavalier about the spiritual path, okay? Because we have a severe continuity problem, very severe. And yet we're making tremendous success, and we're going to succeed. But we still have this tremendous problem also. And until it is evaporated, and even the concept of enlightenment is gone, we still have a severe continuity problem. So never be cavalier. Always be meek, humble, and inclined to being quiet. That your first inclination is to just be quiet, okay? you never go wrong with that. You know, you'll never go wrong with just being quiet. Because your path should be, and it will be and is, that you're making enormous progress. Shockingly enormous progress. And so you're in the wow. If you're not in the wow, you know, something's wrong. If you're just talking, taka, 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 then you're not really practicing. And by taka, 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 I mean trying to establish yourself somehow. Forget about that. Just go back into silence and the wow and make more progress so that you become like, you know, humble and quiet. You say, wow, that's astonishing. I just see my freedom. My gosh, you know. And this definitely reverberates, as I said, through our whole entire expectational structure. So again, never be cavalier about the path. Never be cavalier. If you're overly flippant or cavalier, then you need to be quiet. And focus on the wow and try to full stop in the wow and calm down. Calm down, because what's happened is you've made so much progress, you're not quite able to contain it. And you need to practice more containing the progress, so to speak, or maintaining your poise in the progress. So it's not a knock on anybody, it's saying you've probably been so successful that you can't quite manage it. And so the secret of the path is managing your success. This is the secret. And so you have to get back to managing your success, which is be quiet. Sit quietly. Be humble. Realize you have a very severe problem. Don't underestimate it. Continuity problem. Now, there's all sorts of reasons why people can't seem to do that. All right, that's understood. I'm going to set that aside for a moment here, for a while. Speaking of setting aside stuff for a moment, let's talk about 215. What's going on? Now, we know the exopolitics of what's going on. Many of us do, okay. Which means interaction of this cosmic corporate culture with planet Earth. Call them ETs, space beings, whatever you want to call them. There's a massive interaction going on. There are colonies throughout the solar system. There are very much more advanced stuff going on with this world and its technology than we're even aware of. This has been going on for a long time, last 50 years or so, 50 plus years actually. And all sorts of stuff is going to happen very, very soon, and is happening actually. It's very intense time. And I think many people are feeling, you know, I don't think I can make it. And this is bound to hit us occasionally, for sure. It hits me and keeps hitting me, and it's like, wow, can I really even go forward at all? This is just too much, maybe. And what happens is you can feel suicidal, absolutely. So what I suggest is to stay very wise about it. Just say, oh, okay, notice it, and say, means, wow, I'm making so much success, I feel like almost overwhelmed. Turn it around that way. Don't say I'm failing. Say I'm having to go so fast because of the emergency in this world, really, that is almost overwhelming me how fast I'm going. So in this thought, like, I just want to die, I can't take this anymore, say no suicide right now. Not right now. Say not right now, maybe later. But not right now. Do not try to get into an absolute position with it, because then you don't have the will to sustain an absolute abstract position here in this world at this time. Those on the path do not. So you have to be very smart, very wise, and say, not now. No, not now. I'm not going to do that now. Maybe later. Possible later, but not now. For sure not now. So it's like you're being absolute right now, but you're open, you see the door later. I don't know if I can maintain this absolute position. You see what you're saying? So you don't freak yourself out by saying, well, I have to maintain this absolute position forever. That's too much. Then they'll just come back on you. They'll come back on you. You don't want it to come back on you. So, and it could crop up now. I'm experiencing this. It's cropping up. I just say, wow. This, as I said, it's going, the intensity is right off the bat. It's right off the bat now in 215. You know, the whistleblowers are quite right in many cases of what's going on. And it's scary. And because, you know, it's going to be quite something, as I call it, a collapse into compliance is what's coming. So we want to be enlightened now. You know, we don't want to wait. And then we try to do it and we can't do it. And then we can feel like, you know, like us, terrible. Might as well just die. It's too difficult. So, well, no. I'm going to keep trying. And maybe later I'll give up, but not now. And you sort of have to take this. Maybe later I'll give up, but definitely not now. I'm going to at least, you know, keep trying right now. Maybe later. And you just, you know, say like that. This is a technique that works. It really works. Don't give up. And you can find that each day you can push the despair down the road just another day. Just push it down the road like that. And meanwhile, you're making great progress. And how do we make great progress? Focusing on the root of the situation, the root that generates the whole problem. Okay, so first we think, some people call it centering, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. It's like, wow, we're really talking about this. It's very intense, actually. We're saying, what are we saying? We don't need the universe, actually, is what we're saying. At all. We don't need it. We don't have any needs, actually. Does pure presence, does all pervasiveness, does it need anything in particular to be all pervasive? Does it even need things to be all pervasive? The all pervasiveness is inherently all pervasive. It doesn't need anything in particular or specific to ever arise to be all pervasive. It doesn't need a universe to arise in order for it to be all pervasive. The inherent nature of reality is creative play. So that's just, it's not a need, it's what reality is. But there's nothing that all pervasive needs specifically. At all, ever. That includes this universe, includes this world, includes these bodies, it includes our thoughts, our thinking, our imagination, our wishes, our desires. There's nothing it does not include, actually. All pervasiveness is I am. Now, the continuity problem is our real problem. It's very severe. Now, what happens on the spiritual path, this is what causes the difficulty. This is what generates all the problems, all the circular thinking, reasoning, circular thinking, which makes us feel trapped in, we go unconscious almost, as like in a coma. The circular reasoning that we engage in, actually. We don't realize it, but this is what makes us feel so trapped. It gives us a feeling. And what kind of feeling does it give us? I ask this question, what sort of feeling does sort of circular thinking give us? Going around in circles, what kind of feeling does it give us? Now, I'll answer that in a moment. We'll take a look at it together in a moment. The continuity fear is the problem we have. And how it works is, we come to a point where we realize that it's not a need, rather it's a want. I want this, but I don't need it. We can never need anything. So we say, I want this. We had a glimpse like, oh, this is just what I want, but I'm not bound to it. It's not a need at all. And then suddenly we say, you know what, I don't really want it. And it deepens to, wait, I don't really want this. I'm tired of this. And we realize it's not a need. I'm tired, I want to. And then we say, oh, wait a minute. This is all just a want, a desire, a want. And I can set it down this instant. The whole universe I can set down this instant. Even multiple universes I can set down this instant. There's nothing I can't set down this instant, actually. Except for all pervasiveness. What I am, that's always with me. So, what happens? They put two and two together, continuity, fear, and say, realizing this is just a want, a desire, not a need. The universe is not a need. No one needs it. God doesn't need it. I don't need it. It's not needed. So, what happens? Wow, just a minute. Wow. I can't. This is too scary because I realize I can set this whole thing down this instant. It's not a need. I don't need it. It's not God created. It's not a creation. Okay, that way I'm still free. I'm perfectly free. I don't need anything, actually. I am. And we freak out. This is the continuity verse. I can't set this down, the whole universe down. No, it's too much. I can't do that. And then the continuity fear kicks in. Okay. This is the key area we need to look at. So we relax in the wow, because already it's like, wow, I can feel we're in a very key area here. We don't try to rush it. Don't try to rush it too much.
Happy birthday.
Remember, slow down in order to go faster. Shanti once when he was still Stephen Gray, is just starting out, and he mispronounced my name as Russ, and I always thought he was saying Rush, or Russian, Rush, something Rush. And what did he mean? I never could understand what he meant, but I just got it right now. He was feeling like I'm rushing, I'm trying to rush too much. That's right. Somehow intuitively, you know, it came through him like I'm trying to rush it. And that doesn't work. That was about 16 years ago or so, 17 years ago. And I felt that, you know, I got what I needed to get. I just didn't quite understand it, but somehow it had some help. So you get help along the way from many, many places, really many little, if you are really open to being helped, you find out you get little clues that are potent. So we're not trying to rush too much here. We realize this universe, we don't really want it. We realize it's not a need. The continuity problem overwhelms us. We say, well, I can't put this whole thing down right now. But you want to, you see, and you feel this want. I really want to set this down. And then, whoa, wait a minute, this is too scary. What happens? What happens? What you want at that point is to have it be a need. You want it to be a need. And you feel that saves you and protects you from setting it all down instantly. Okay, now, what happens then? What happens next is you engage in what's called circular reasoning. And what this does is generates this feeling of need, what we at least think is need. It generates something that makes you feel like this is something given to you, like the world is a need for you, because you're stuck. You say, I can't get free, so I must need it. It must be a need, an intrinsic need that I have. And so circular reasoning comes to the rescue. It's a defense system. Defense system is really all kind of circular logic, really. And the reason why we cannot dispel the spiritual path academically, intellectually, is because of the severity of our continuity fear. So I cannot just sit here and explain circular reasoning, point it out to you, and you say, oh, I got it. Okay, I should be enlightened now. It never works that way. A little while later, you'll completely forget it because you have a need to feel, you think you have a need to feel needy. I need this world. This is needed. Somehow God gave this to me. Someone gave it to me. It's part of a need that I have. I'm not complete without it. You see? So we get this feeling that calms us down, like, oh, and you feel like, oh, okay, now I'm not so scared. And you're relieved in some way, like, oh, yeah. But you've gone back into like sort of a coma of circular thinking. The reason, again, why academically I cannot just point out, and I can say this, you can't, a teacher cannot really teach here. You can't teach enlightenment. You cannot teach enlightenment. So don't worry about you being a teacher. You cannot be a teacher in that way. You cannot teach it. Because what's really going on is the continuity fear. It's so severe that we rush back and we say, I have to have that feeling of need again. I have to have that feeling of need. And you can start thinking circularly in whatever way. There's infinite ways you can do it. So trying to like pin down, okay, this way of circular thinking is not good, and this way is not, and this way is not. There are infinite ways to do it. So it's futile. It's futile. This is why the Milarepa, the Tibetan, the famous story of a guru or something, in Tibetan gurus saying, hey, build a stone house here, and wait a minute, I don't like it where it is, move it over here. It's a problem, the sun is no good there, move it over here. So he's moving these stones one by one for years and years and years, and finally, you know, he gets it. He says, this isn't the way. This is not the way. And this is what's being talked about. You cannot teach it that way. This is it. So you cannot just academically be a teacher like that. You cannot just point out to enlightenment to somebody and say, this is it. Just get rid of that circular thinking and you're free. So it seems that easy, doesn't it? And some pseudo teachers, maybe that's what they do. It's possible, right? But that doesn't work. You can glimpse circular reasoning and think, wow, and then somehow do something conceptually about it and think, I've got it. And then turn that, I got it, into, you know, something you think that is it. It's not it. Because there's infinite ways that you can do circular reasoning. Infinite, not reasoning, or thinking, circular thinking. Infinite ways. And just like those carrying those stones, one stone after another, and you just get so tired of this, I can't do it. This is wearing me out. You don't have to do it that way. In fact, you can't do it that way, really. So there'll be times when you glimpse circular reasoning, circular thinking. You say, wow. And today I did. I just saw through. I said, wow. You know, I said, for me, it's easy now. Many times a day I see through it. But I just say, wow. Okay, wow. But I don't try to do anything about it. I just notice it and say, okay. I said, but that's not it. Don't let me chase after that. Don't let me struggle to try and get it. Because what's happening is the continuity fear. It will be generating infinite, you know, all sorts of more circular thinking to produce this sort of pseudo feeling of need. So you say, I feel I have a need. You say, oh, great. Because what are we afraid of? No need. A feeling of no need, which is bliss. Our inherent feeling is the feeling of no need whatsoever, which is bliss. This is inherently how we feel without us doing anything at all. You know, this is how we, this is our natural state, is this bliss, this perfect bliss. No need. And we're afraid, like, wow, I can't set the whole world down, the universe down. What is this, the, you know, time, space, process form? It's too scary for me. So I want to feel this. I don't want to feel that bliss. I want to feel needy. I want to feel like I have a need. And this circular thinking produces this trappedness. It produces a feeling that we interpret as this means I have a need. So as long as we have the continuity fear, we cannot be enlightened. That's impossible. We will merely be playing games with semantics and concepts and states of mind and all this kind of stuff. And it's a waste of time. It's a waste of time. And this is what the Tibetan guru was pointing out. This is to his disciple, you know. This is all a waste of time, isn't it? And after all these years of moving the house here, moving the house there, all these stones, one day, you know, the guru looks up and they look at each other and says, it's a waste of time, isn't it? The devotee says, hey, this is all a waste of time, isn't it? And the guru says, yeah, it's all a waste of time, isn't it? And then, you know, as the story goes. But this points out what it's all about. What it's all about is realizing, hey, you cannot do it that way. We cannot do it that way. Because of this continuity fear, which is an expression of our creativity, actually. We wouldn't have this continuity fear if we weren't incredibly creative to try and deceive ourselves into believing we had a need, that creation is incomplete and we need to complete it. You know, this is our belief. We had this adventure. What if creation was incomplete and we were able to complete it? You know, this is the adventure. You know, this is, what if creation wasn't complete? You know, what if we needed to do something in order to complete it? What if we needed to do something to complete it? Well, guess what? We don't need to do anything to complete it. We do not need to do anything to complete it. But we now have this massive apparatus of doing, suppose, you know, process, we think, even though it isn't. But it seems that way. And we're all used to all this, these props. And so we say, I can't set these props down. It's just, I'm too used to them. That's crazy. I don't know why I'm scared. And then so we go back to, I need to complete something. I need this world. I mean, I need to come up with completing something. I need to complete something. I need to complete reality. And so this world is our workshop where we're working on something to complete reality, you see. So we think we need it. But actually, when we check in with ourselves, we don't need it. And that scares the heck out of us. And so we engage in this confusion, mental confusion. We call it insanity, actually. We engage in, you know, to be really direct, we engage in insanity is what we do. But we cannot directly go at insanity and say, this is what you're doing wrong. Because insanity can be infinite ways to be, you know, to confuse. Confusion can take on any symbolic types of symbolism, you know, infinitely. It's useless. And plus, with still continuity, for still that, we still need it. So we're just chasing our tail by doing it that way. This is why it's so important that you keep practicing full stop. Okay, wow, I see that. Wow, that's fantastic. Very important. Full stop. Okay, just wow. Just wow. Don't draw any conclusions. Wow, I just saw through insanity. Okay, great. Wow. I just dispelled that form of insanity. Okay. Wow. Insanity can be dispelled. Great. And let it generalize just to all. So insanity can be dispelled. Okay, just wow. Don't start, see, here's, so if you dispel a form of insanity, you say insanity can be dispelled, that's great. And then what do you do? You say, wow, okay, let me look for some more insanity. I want to dispel it all. That's the mistake. That's struggling with the struggle, so to speak. You just struggle to dispel insanity. Now don't continue to struggle by saying, I can dispel all these different forms of insanity. And it's like saying, hey, I just moved this rock and I can move all the rocks, move the house over there. Say, no. Full stop. And you say, okay, just let me, full stop. I see it's possible to dispel all insanity. Now, just let me stay full stop for a while. And then it comes up, you say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe I don't even need insanity. Maybe I can dispel it, all of it all at once. And the continuity just, ooh, you know. Wait a minute. And then you see, full stop in that, you see. This is the chain, this sort of chain comes up, like, should I struggle with it or not? And then if I don't, it means I can dispel it all at once, yes, but maybe that's too quick. So you just have to look, just say stop, and then just gently just full stop in the, wow, this is a very intense situation. Because you're considering letting it go all go at once. That's a very intense situation. So instead of struggling any further, just stop and say, hey, wait, let me just sit down. Let me just calm down here. Let me just calm down and be on this one right now. How do you get rid of it all at once? Really, I don't need it anymore. I don't need it anymore. Insanity will stay with us as long as we need it. As long as we think we need it. Okay, as long as we think we need it. Now, there's one other clarification that can be made here. Very crucial clarification, and let's see if we're ready for it. Just first check in with, you know, the wow factor. Is it possible? Is this too much or not? One other problem that we face, one other difficulty we struggle with, and so you may get this, you say, I get it, but I say, there's something else that is just, you know, somehow I'm not quite getting it. What is it? Okay, there's one other difficulty that I see, just saw today. There may be others, or maybe this is it, I don't know. I've said we don't need anything. We don't need anything, but we're terrified of that, so we generate this feeling of need through insanity. Now, what can happen and does happen is the spiritual path, what we do is we turn that into a need. Indeed, the spiritual path, and this is a great mistake, we think we can go quicker, faster, if we turn it into a need, if we see it as a need. But we cannot generate a feeling of need except through insanity. And so what happens is that stalls us out. It stalls us out on the path. At some point, the continuity theory realizes, hey, I can drop the whole thing. It's not a need. I'm not bound by it in the slightest bit. And then we say, whoa, that's too much. And then what we do is we say, well, I don't want to appear to be stupid or slow. Let me make the spiritual path a need. There's something I need to do. Now, this is very subtle. Point here, very subtle here, but we don't even need the spiritual path, actually. We cannot have a need, including the spiritual path. It's a want. I want to do it. I really want to do the spiritual path, but it's never a need. And we can never turn it into a need. And what we think is, if we just turn it into a need, we could go really fast and get it done like that. Because I need to do it. It's an intrinsic need, but it is not an intrinsic need. And I know this is the mistake I made. As I said to Jesus, I said, Jesus, look at the problems they're having. I think I have a way to help more. You know, the world needs more help. I got to help out, and I see a way to do it. And of course, Jesus said, no, you're making a mistake. But I said, no, I see. I think, you know, maybe you needed to do something more. And so I said, what I did was I turned the path into a need. Like spirituality, spiritual path, spirit, as I said, if I make it feel like a need to me then, and to others, they'll be able to finish so fast in time, you know. See, that's the mistake. That is the crucial mistake. Because as soon as you desire for a need, where part of you is very spiritual and the other part of you is very confused. And then you get into the stall out mode, and then you get into this mode where you can't stop your mind. You got to talk. It's a kind of compulsive situation where you're not able really to have this full stop in the wow and actually make progress. The progress you're making is spinning your wheels. So what happens is you end up spinning your wheels and you become very spiritually intellectual. And you keep spinning your wheels, but you're not really making the progress that you want to make, that you really want to make. So God cannot turn the spiritual path into a need. We are absolutely free, so we can never have any need. So it is never a need, but it can be something we really want. So we have to look at it as something we really want, but not a need, which means we do have to practice and work at it. We can never turn it into a need. This is a crucial mistake I made, and I see so many others have made this too. It's very subtle, because we think out of compassion, we think we see a way to speed everything up. And we fall into the trap of feeling as if it's a need and thinking this is what can do it for us. We say, you need to do this. You have to do it. You need. And a level of confusion comes in, because ultimately we have no choice but to recognize we have no needs, because we don't have any. We already don't have any needs. It's already the situation we're in. You can't escape it. It's in our reality is totally inescapable. But we can continue to this delusion of needs forever if we want to. If that's what we really want, we're free to do so. But we really don't want to. So you could say we need to set it down, but this is a different definition. This is a different way of using the term need. Meaning, it's really meaning we have no choice but to set it down, actually. If we want to experience something else, we have no choice to set it down. We can't have dual allegiance to neediness, the belief in neediness, and our true reality with no needs. We cannot have a dual allegiance. It's impossible. So once we realize that it's impossible, there's nowhere else to go with it except realize I don't really want this. But it's never a need to set it down. It's I really want to set it down. This is a subtle point. And this is where deep down we have trouble. But if we just can look at this as we are, we say, oh, okay, yeah. And so that's why teachers, you need to realize you don't have any needs. And people say, wait, you know. But this is, you have to understand the potential for level confusion is always there using words. But it's just a semantic thing. It's not really a contradiction at all. It's like we have no choice but to be what we are, which is free of it all. Free. It's not even free of needs. There's no such thing as needs. There's not even I don't have any needs. No, there's not even awareness that such a thing is impossible. Because it's not like reality is aware of what's impossible. It's just that since it's impossible, there's no need to be aware of any consideration whatsoever for what's impossible. There's no consideration for that whatsoever. But in our situation here, some would say, well, you need to realize you don't have any needs. But really what they're saying is, you really want to realize that there are no needs. You really want to realize that. You don't actually need to. So this is the trickiness of it. So you don't, and then people get stuck, they get level confusion, and because of the feeling that they wanted to keep needs, they say, oh good, here's a way for me to be insane and feel like I have a need. Insanity gives us this feeling like you have a need. That's what it does. That's what it uses for. So we can go from feeling insane or feeling like we have a need to bliss. We can go directly, right? You know, just flip the script. Absolutely. In fact, ultimately, that's the only place, that's all we can do, is either have this artificial generation of what we think is a need, neediness, or bliss. One of the two. That's it. That's all we have to choose between, actually. See, that's it. There's no other choice. So you can say, well, we need to make a choice. No, we can keep what we have, which is this feeling of neediness, or we can choose bliss. So it's what, it's what do we want? What do we really want is the real question. There's not a question of need. So if you're able to look at this and you've been stuck, you no doubt you're going to recognize, aha. And then what I say is full stop in the wow, or the aha, wow. Just oh wow. And don't get trapped in thinking, yeah, okay, that's great, but now let me slingshot this into some greater depth and all this. No. Don't do that. Because this is very central and profound. And if this doesn't produce a wow in you, then you're already enlightened, actually. I would say most likely, okay, let's put it this way, very, very likely, you're already enlightened. And you don't even need to be viewing this at all, actually. It's absolutely crucial and central to singularity, to abiding in singularity, that this is recognized. That you, as to remain in singularity, that no one has any needs. You don't need to be a teacher. You can never need to be a teacher. This is my mistake I made. I felt if I just feel like I need to be a teacher, then I'll be a great teacher. You see, that's the mistake. And I'm pretty sure that many are stuck in this. And I'm pretty sure some who watch these videos are stuck in this, as I have been stuck in this. And it's no shame for anyone, because this is very key and subtle. And if this gets resolved, then you will be a teacher, for sure. When this gets resolved, it will. So, but we don't rush to force the resolution, do we? As Adyashanti told me, are you rush, or what is this? Are you rushing too much? Yeah, maybe that's the problem. So don't rush. That's why we spend time here. Very important is you give yourself time to have the insight, but not to rush about it. So we've already looked at this now, haven't we? So now what do we do? Well, we don't rush. We don't rush. Where's the... One moment, I'm getting a phone call. Okay. Here's a great example, a really great example. Because I just received a phone call, and actually I need to do some work. I need to pick some stuff up. And I'm receiving another phone call. So, we're right on the brink, you see, of what shifting into bliss is possible. Right? I said, but wait, don't rush it. Just let it set in. Realize this is where I live now. This is where I live. This is the area that I live in. So I'm not going to try to rush somewhere else right away. This is the area that I live in. Now, time-wise, what can I do is the question. Do I rush off? Possible. Will I forget? No. Not really, because I'm not trying to push it further, right, at this point. This is very important. Once you make this very profound recognition, is don't try to grab the bliss. Don't try to grab the bliss. This is very important, because it'll slip through your fingers. This dynamic of generating a feeling of need out of a continuity fear the fact that you can't be a better teacher by believing you need to be a teacher. You can't need to be a teacher. You can only really want to be. You can't need to be a teacher. So as soon as you generate the feeling of need within you, you're actually insane and are not a teacher. And you can't, you only then teach level confusion. Even though it may be a beautiful level, seemingly beautiful level confusion, that causes severe problems. Because then you have a split mind, actually, or a seemingly split mind. And actually, most of the people in the world have a very split mind. The good side and the bad sides. They have a really, really good, but also really, really bad. You know, and the good hides the bad, actually, in this world. The good people are just, it's like a mask they're wearing to hide the part that is super needy and desperate and you know, wicked and all this stuff, you know. So don't try to grab the bliss. Because that you're saying, I need to be a teacher. And that pops up again. And then it slips through your fingers because the circular reasoning comes in, and then you get super frustrated and then you become suicidal. You can, absolutely. Because you think, I just had it, and I need it right now, and it's gone, and I can never succeed, I can't stand this anymore, blah, 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 blah. You know, and this is the trouble. So instead of trying to grab it and having it slip through your fingers, say, no, I'm not even going to try to reach out and grab it, actually. It's okay, I live right here, I live right next door. It's not a problem, I live right next door here. Because we're not trying to grab a need, we're not trying to generate need. And this is our whole problem, because we can't really generate need. We continually say, I don't like this need, I need another one. I don't like how this feels. And we never like how it feels. We never like how insanity feels, actually. But we're not trying to generate a feeling of need. So we just say, it's okay then. We're not going to forget it and be all confused and everything, no. If we full stop in the wow consciously like this, we're going to feel like, hey, this is where I live. No problem. I just look right here. I see it. It's right here. This is where I am. And so you don't retreat into confusion, and that's how you make progress. By not retreating into confusion, the first order of business is don't retreat into confusion, into insanity. Don't retreat into that. How do we retreat? By trying to grab a hold of bliss is how we retreat. It's trying to say, I need to grab it. I need bliss. No, we don't need bliss. We are bliss. You can never have a need for bliss and bliss at the same time. It's impossible. Because, you see, it's impossible. Well, you say, but the world needs. No, no one needs anything. The world really wants to let go of this fake feeling of need, for sure, yeah, right. But the only way they're going to do it is to recognize they don't have any needs. They're going to have to evaporate the continuity fear. It's not going to happen by trying to rush things. It doesn't happen that way. Rush it through, say, I need to do this, I need it. That makes things worse. It makes it worse. So to speed up, slow down. Slow down to speed up, actually. Still working on that kale and avocado smoothie and flaxseed. Kale, avocado, and flaxseed smoothie. Yeah, it's gonna take a long time to finish that one. I can only drink so much of it at a time. It's just ridiculously thick and filling and just bulky and wow. What a monster. But I did have a smoothie today, which I treated myself to. Banana, one banana, handful of walnuts, 4 pieces of 87% cocoa chocolate bar, 80% cocoa chocolate bar, 4 pieces of that, a whole bunch of sesame seeds and milk. Ah, man, that was good. That was awesome. Just awesome. Rich. I was just... made up for the breakfast of cranberry juice and banana and protein powder. But I'm still rocked by that smoothie, chocolate smoothie. Wow, never tasted anything like that, I'm telling you. That was really something. Discipline is full stop in the way out. Don't say, I need to get to bliss. This is what throws you into trouble. And all these difficulties spin off of this. So many difficulties. And you can avoid those difficulties by and large through this practice of full stop in the wow, with a situation where someone is saying, this is what, do this, it's okay to do this. You have my permission not to be blissful, okay? Give yourself permission not to be blissful, prime first, okay? So I'm giving myself the permission in this practice to not succeed, actually, to not be blissful. I'm giving myself permission for that. You have every right to. You don't need to be blissful. You inherently are. You don't have a need to be. You see? So I don't need to be blissful. I don't need to be blissful. I don't need to be blissful. I don't. It's a very subtle point, but it's very important if you can see this. I don't need to be blissful. So give yourself permission. I don't need to be blissful. I am blissful, but I don't need to be blissful. So that way you can just full stop, say, okay, I recognize the dynamic here. Very potent. It's like drinking that smoothie. Let me tell you, it took a while. I had to go slow. It's so rich. Oh, man. So, it's not something you just gulp down. I tried to gulp it down. I said, no, wait a minute. I got to hold on. Let me get used to this. I mean, get used to what I just drank. This is potent stuff. I don't know if I can handle this, actually. Good Lord. And then after a while, I drank some more. And after a while, I drank some more. And it's like that. Give yourself permission. You don't have to chug it. You don't have to chug the spiritual path. You don't have to chug it. And when something ancillary arises, and it seems to be too much, just say, okay, wait. I'll deal with that later. I know I can clarify that later, but right now it doesn't seem appropriate. There's other stuff I could bring into this, but it's already enough, right? It's just like I could throw more stuff in the smoothie. I could have thrown cashews in the smoothie too, right? But let me first get used to how rich this is before I throw the cashews into the smoothie too. Because that would be banana, walnuts, cashews, sesame seeds, and 87% cocoa chunks bar. And milk, wow. I suppose you could throw in half and half cream too, if you really want to go all the way, go all in. Or pure cream, walnuts, cashews, and the cocoa, and a banana. Holy cow. I put you on the moon. Go right through a wormhole, that'll probably open up a wormhole, you'd be right on the moon. Ooh. cream, walnut, cashew, banana, 87 cocoa smoothie, and then chug it, and whoa, wormhole opens up. Maybe, maybe not. Don't be in too much of a hurry to work, open that wormhole, you know, to bliss.
Yeah.
Don't be in too much of a hurry here. And you're thinking, I could have had bliss, I could have had it, I could have. No, no, no. You don't need to have it. You are it, and it's different than needing to have it. Because you have to realize there are no needs, you have no needs. And that's a different, you don't get bliss until you realize, you accept you don't have any needs at all. That's the only way. Because you already have bliss. And the only way you can not experience it is to believe that you have needs. Or a need, that neediness is possible. I need, what is the I need, is really the I need. So are we doing what, like Ramana Maharshi? Yes, absolutely. Similar, similar. But we don't have to do the same. It's not necessary. I had that dream, well, it wasn't a dream, it was a real meeting with Ramana. Back in about the year 2000 or so, and or it could have been 1999, 2001, something around, I can't quite remember, but, and he came up to me and he said, look, he says, look, I know that so many people are following me, doing this eye inquiry. He says, okay, I said, yeah, and so he says, that's fine, that's great. He says, okay, I can see that you're working on an approach, and he says, it's a really great approach. He said, just keep doing it. Don't worry about the semantics of, you know, I, self-inquiry, all that, you know, this around Ramana Maharshi, Bhagwan, it gets a little pedantic, it can. He says, don't even worry about that, forget about it. It's this, you know, you do your thing, it's going to get you there, okay? You're going to succeed at this, just don't worry. It's a little different style, but it's the same basic. It's the same basic thing, right? Yeah. It's the same basic situation. It'll lead to the same bliss. It will lead to the same bliss. So he was adamant about it, you know. He says, don't, because I was getting really depressed, thinking like, how come nobody picks up on this, but it's the same really, but it's just a slightly different angle of approach or something. And he said that he saw it just very clearly. Yeah, this is very much. And again, Jesus' approach is very similar to Ramana Maharshi. It's really the same approach. It just uses different terminology. Okay, uses different. I've never been comfortable using the I term for some reason. I'm not comfortable with that. It's just. So that's fine. There's different approaches. Use just different verbiage. That people feel comfortable with, then that's fine. Don't worry about the other ones. It's all the same. So we are doing real self-inquiry here, absolutely. We don't call it the self. Or, you know, don't use those terms so much as the Advaitin terms so much. But you don't need to. Don't need to. Jesus' terms are just as valid, actually. Just as valid. I know some say Ramana is like the greatest ever. Yeah, I don't say that. I don't think Ramana said that. It's all one. Jesus is just as good as Ramana. Or you can say Ramana is just as good as Jesus. I know Christians will hate that. You'll say, no, Jesus is the best. And when you're talking about reality, there is no best. It's all one. It's all one. And in so, one that has realized, there are no needs. There is no I needness. There is no need for completeness. Then the completeness is realized. And so there is no best to the completeness. The completeness is realized. That's it. That's it. The completeness is realized. Because of the path, way the path is, there's a need, there's feel, well not a need, but there is this sense of needing it. I need to have a need. I need a feeling of need. So I need Jesus or I need Ramana. It's like that. And so you try to say, well, it's not that. Oh, no. See, continuity fear gets too severe. So you got to be careful and don't argue about that at all. The guru is now serving the notion of need. I need this guru. And see, this is the tricky part. That's very tricky now. Substitute for generating. Say, well, I don't have insanity, but if I drop insanity, where's my need going to come from? Oh, I need Ramana. You see, like that. There is no Ramana there. That's what I saw. I was looking at a picture of Ramana, and what happened is I looked deeper. I suddenly went beyond looking into seeing. And what I saw was there is no Ramana there. I said, wow. That was a super wow. I said, there is no Ramana Maharshi there at all. Wow. So I went from looking to seeing. And I sort of jumped back. I said, wow. Now that was intense. That was really intense. But see, as long as this issue, this dynamic of need is there and hasn't been properly seen, you will think that you need Ramana. You need Ramana. You need Jesus. I need Jesus. Jesus, where are you? I need you. I need you. I need you as a body. I need you as something determinate. I need time, space, process, form. But when you shift from looking, from the need standpoint, you need to see, then you realize that there is no Jesus there. There is no Ramana there. There's only oneness there. There's only allness. There's only completeness. There's only inherent isness there. That's all there is. There was no Ramana Maharshi there at all, actually. But that form can still be used. Isness can still use that form, and does. Actually, I had the experience of isness simply using the form. But as I said, it's like the most wonderful quote-unquote person I've ever met in this while I was asleep. It's just, the absolute kindest, just, you can't even express how appropriate he was, but it's just isness using that form to continue to help us, knowing that we have this struggle, of course, with the continuity problem. But actually, that there is no Ramana Maharshi. Never has been, actually. Just like saying there's never been a Jesus. There's never been an actual Jesus in the way we look at it. It's just the isness using the form, this form that we call Jesus. But the actual isness is not identified with this form. And Ananda Mai Ma said that the isness that was present, the isness was there, never identified with the form. So she said, for me, the isness said, for me, for this, there is no Ananda Mai Ma, there is no person here or anything like that. Not even, never identify with it at all. It's just a empty shell, nothing, empty shell. But people say, yeah, like Ma is, hey, Ma, you're here, thank you for coming, you're here. This is how it goes. So, but we're looking at this dynamic, and you say, okay, we see the dynamic. It's very, it's very profound. Yet we say, okay, I'm just gonna, I'm gonna make this my home for a little while. I'll just live here for a little while. That's fine. No, all right. Don't rush. Slow down to speed up. Slow down in order to speed up. So, is there a teacher Ramana Maharshi? No, there is not. It's the isness is what was there. It is the teacher. And when we can see that, realize there is no need. Isness doesn't have any needs. Isness doesn't need to be a teacher, you see? Isness does not need to be, isness has no needs, including it has no need to be a teacher. That's why there is no Ramana Maharshi there. And ultimately, there are no teachers, actually. Not really. Not really. And we don't need any teachers, actually. Not really. And this is where we live right now. We're just living here. We're not trying to grab the bliss. We just say, okay, this is where we live. This is fine for right now. This is fine. Well, okay. Let me... This is very much wow, of course. And sharing this is a big wow. It's one thing to keep it to yourself, but to share it freely with the whole universe here, really, as is whatever. There's, actually, in the world now, it is open to the universe, cosmos, pretty much. There's all sorts of beings, entities here in this world and other places they can pick up, probably on YouTube, and share it. Maybe the sharing is going beyond this planet, actually. Maybe this, some videos are being shared in on bases on Mars and Titan and various places in the cosmos, you know, and maybe they're watching someplace in some Sirius lodge on Sirius. They're watching a YouTube video. Maybe they're watching this video. It's possible. It's very possible. And they're saying, yeah, I like this. This is very profound. But again, wherever you are, if you're in a lodge on Sirius, or Zeta Reticuli, or on Mars base, or wherever you happen in this world, wherever you happen to be, remember, full stop on the wow. Just full stop on the wow. Just say, okay, wow. Let me just, don't try to grab the bliss. Let me just get used to it. This is really wow. Wow, I really, this is really something, huh? It's really great. Wow. And just be a little patient. Be a little patient. Okay. All right. Very great. Something's going on. I'm going to do the work now. Very great. That's it.